It's difficult. You know, you got a new director, producer, camera guy, they change things up on them. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. This is a regularly scheduled meeting of the Sunderland Board of Selectmen. Today is January 30th. Call to order at 6:32. We got a interesting thing tonight. We're going to talk with the library and their budget. We're going to talk first with Bob Hemmer.
Yep.
Bob is looking for a possible connection to town sewer on Park Road.
Correct.
So what we will do is the Board of Selectmen will now put on their sewer commissioner's hats. We are multi-talented. Sherry, so let it be known far and wide that the Sunderland Board of Selectmen are now sewer commissioners. Bob, why don't you come on up front and give us your thoughts.
Yeah, so Bob Hemmer and this is Barbara Meehan, and we each represent a lot that was subdivided into two recently. We closed on it on the 30th of December.
Congratulations.
Thank you. And we were wondering, since we're putting in two lots, and we know that it's always preferable to have a sewer as opposed to a septic system, if there's been any precedent for, you know, the town putting in sewer lines at that point, how we would go about that, what are the issues involved, and we're looking for recommendations from you all on that.
Okay. So now the lot is actually on the two lots?
It was one lot that was subdivided.
Subdivided off. And that lot is actually on?
They're both on Park.
They're both on Park.
It's the first lot beyond Worcester.
Okay. On the left-hand side or the right-hand side?
Right-hand side.
Oh, so it used to be kind of like a field over there.
It's a big field.
Okay.
So we had spoken to Sherry, and then Sherry recommended that we speak with, I think, Rich Brinda.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And he actually met us up at that point, took a look at what was there. Said from what he could see, actually looked like it was very viable. It's downhill from where it is.
Say, your elevation on your side, if I could, yeah.
Exactly, and not too far from the
right.
Last manhole on North Silver.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
So he recommended that we come and speak with you all.
Okay, so just review everybody so everybody understands what happens. The town many years ago privatized our sewer. So if something were to happen, like we didn't treat the water wasn't treated right or whatever, we'd still get the DEP and EPA fines, but the day-to-day operation is left. We put it out for bid every few years. Present time, Warner Brothers has the they are our operator. Rich is kind of the manager, engineer of that. So what we did is Sherry referred this, and Bob, you talked to him also. And we have you seen Rich's letter?
No, it just came today.
Oh, just came in today? Okay. Scott, I want to give him a copy of this.
Yep.
Can I borrow yours for a second?
Sure. Okay.
All right. So what Rich did is Rich went up, looked at it. He made a few notes that the last manhole on the line is approximately 150 feet south of the intersection of Park Street. And it appears that the manhole has a sub inside to the north that would allow for future service. Good. Pipe is 8 inch, depth is about 5 feet. And it says, now, in order to extend the sewer line up to Mr. He said Hemming, but it's Hemmer, correct?
Correct.
Property, the following would need to be done. Two new sewer manholes would need to be installed with an approximate depth to invert of 5 feet. 450 to 500 feet of new sewer line would need to be installed up to the property, and the road surface would need to be restored. He said he ran some quick budget numbers to provide the work described above. and came up with a budgetary cost of $40,000. All right, so he said it can be done. The cost is pretty high. That being said, we have worked with residents in the past that have done private extensions. So what we do is we talk to, you know, we talk to them. They have to meet some minimum, well, the minimum requirements are, they have an engineer draw up some plans, then they can tie into our into the sewer, and they can become a sewer user at the same time. They would maintain the maintenance on those lines until, and with the town would accept them.
Who would maintain those?
The private individual, from the house lot to the connection point. So, Scott, do you have any questions or thoughts?
One thought, Mr. Chair, is that we did a similar line for an expansion over at Kitchen Garden, and that was almost 300 feet of private way. That was force main. Mm-hmm. I want to say 4 or 5 years ago anyway now.
It was pressure too, right?
It was pressured, yeah.
Pressurized?
Wouldn't have that issue here with elevations on this side.
Right.
But that was a pressurized main inside of the town taking, and we granted that single connection. This would, I think, be modeled similarly, and that'll be a pair of connections.
Mm-hmm. So that would be, well, David, thoughts?
I don't have any questions or anything on it. Yeah, I'm in agreement with you guys on that part of it. So,
one thing, if I could, Mr. Chair, the last time we did a tie to the system, that was a long length, right? Even with gravity, there was relatively little road work. In this case here, Rich points out there is going to be some road work regardless. That's going to be from extending along Silver to at least Park to wherever that tie ends up being.
Yeah. Right. With those numbers, I would have a hard time, the town sewer users, putting up $40,000 for a lot. That would be, that'd be hard for me to accept or recommend. I don't have a problem. If you wanted to explore a private tie-in, that's well within your right, and we would talk to you about that. Or if you want to, you know, continue the conversation with Rich and understand where his numbers are coming from, that would be important also. And that probably would be the best for you to get a better understanding.
And is there any grant money available that you're aware of? I mean, I've heard this from different people. I think, Sherry, you mentioned that sometimes there was grant money out there, or that we should inquire about that.
Well,
since
a few,
the state often does want, right, for sewer septic, is there grant money available?
There could be. The original treatment plant and septic sewer system was done partly through grants. I know sewers are harder to come by right now. We had 3 years ago, David, we had a study done. Was it three, 4 years ago?
On the south side.
And we looked at extending the sewer down in the south portion of town. And I think it was like $3-5 million.
It was
very expensive. At that time, there wasn't a lot of hope to seek grants. I don't know if that's changed. We can look into that. But this is just speculative on my part. Typically, a single family home is not something that they're looking at. They're looking at more system-wide, but there may be something out there. We can look. Sherry can look for us, help us look.
Yeah, and this is two families, right? So that's the only reason
we're thinking
about that. Yeah. So two single-family homes.
Correct.
Okay, yeah.
One
home on
each.
Got it, yep.
Okay. So that could be a possibility. Bruce?
Just as an alternative, it might be less expensive ways of doing this. I just connected to the town sewer. What I did is I put a septic tank in, and then I put a separate pump facility in. We just pump the liquids down to the town sewer. And that's only like a 2 or 3 inch plastic pipe. And that might be a cheaper alternative because we probably wouldn't have to do as much road work and stuff. I would have a problem with spending $40,000 of the town's money, with the sewer users' money, for two houses.
And again, if that particular street, it's not like you're not going to build infrastructure to pick up 10 or 12
there
more.
There isn't going to be anything
right,
more.
Right, right.
And I think you're going to have problems there too, because as you go up, there's a hill that goes up and then it goes down.
Yep.
And I think you'd have to dig a pretty deep trench, to get underneath, to get a gravity feed from where I assume you would put the houses, because it does go down a little bit. And there's a knoll there, and that knoll might have some ledge in it.
I would agree with with Bruce on that one, where sometimes you can do things privately that we wouldn't do because of we try to maintain the integrity of the system, and you don't start, and we can't start piecemealing our system together. But if you were to tie in the manhole, if you want, 3 inch, 4 inch, you could get Ray to come in and do some directional boring and not even disturb the road.
No trenching.
And companies like that are very affordable to do, but it's something that we wouldn't do because, if we're going to go up, if we're going to spend any dollars to go up the road, we're going to make it so that other people can tie into it, not just make it for one or two users. But you could try that. And you can actually talk to Rich, and Rich may be able to point you in the direction of somebody that could help you with that also.
So we'll talk to Rich, he'll let us know if there's any grant money, and then we'll just assume it's private unless otherwise.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, great, thanks.
Thanks so much.
Okay. 6:45, we have a joint meeting with the Finance Committee. And we're going to talk tonight about the library budget. Do you guys have copies of the library budget?
We just got an email today.
Does anybody?
Yeah. You have extra copies?
No.
It's okay.
We can do this.
Do anybody need more? You guys all set?
Yep.
Okay.
Thank you.
Hi, Francis. All right, here we go. Library, your floor.
Great. So we are requesting a $1,728 increase in the new library building operating fund. This funding is, we're asking for additional funding to support an improved security system for the library. The library will be handling the installation of all of that, but we'd like to have the town cover the increased fees for monitoring. We've been having a hard time with our former company just not monitoring the building. I really don't feel like it's safe in their hands. And so making the switch over would be a very small way to make sure the library stays functioning. So essentially we're asking for a total increase of $168 to raise the, you know, to for the $34 per month monitoring charge. The rest of the funding that we're asking for in that line is $1,560 to improve the wireless internet at the library. Right now, the wireless internet's painfully slow. painfully slow. We have patrons come up and show me speed tests on their phone. You know, it's much faster, you know, at my home in my parking lot. And so internet's a really crucial service that we offer at the library. I mean, people come in just to use the wireless all hours of the night. You can ask the police if there's people sitting out in the car using the wireless internet. But in the building, too, it's really important. I mean, everyone who's in there is using the wireless. And right now, we receive a free internet from Comcast, and it's at the starter level, of course, which is good for 1 to 2 users, is what they describe. But it's really, I mean, anyone who walks in the building with their cell phone who's connected, once they automatically connect to it, so we can have up to, you know, 30 people connected to our wireless at any given time. So we'd like to increase this to the Deluxe 100 service level, which would be an additional cost of $130 per month with a municipal discount. And we kind of view that as just like it's the basic services like any other utility charge.
So, what do you guys feel about having the wireless internet that someone can sit in the parking lot? Do you have concerns about security at that point?
I don't. We've never had a problem. It's people just using the internet. I mean, they're sitting in their cars. They're not damaging anything outside. And we've had minor incidences, and I can't prove if it's after hours or in hours, where people have, like, downloaded something illegally. That's happened 3 times since I've been here. It's really not an issue. We've never had any malicious attacks. As far as I know, there haven't been any security.
Now, is that typical to have libraries in just to have? I mean, wouldn't you want it at the minimum some type of password? I mean, someone could come in and get the thing, the password. But wouldn't it be better to have some type of password protection versus?
We prefer not to. It just makes it much easier rather than having someone come to the desk every 5 minutes to ask for it. You know, it's much simpler, it's easier to connect. We've never had an issue with
it. Wi-Fi is inherently insecure, but it's what we all kind of buy into when we are in a public space. The town of Amherst has public Wi-Fi throughout the town.
Yeah, I'm a library trustee, and I'm the chair as well. There are actually 2 issues here that we want to address. One has to do with the tier of service the library currently receives. It's totally inadequate. If you're going to have internet Wi-Fi service in the library, we need to move to a higher service tier than the one we have now. Catherine did the research on this with our service provider, and we do get a substantial discount for much higher download and upload rates. We're eligible to be, it's a municipal discount that we receive. The other part of this is we need to upgrade the equipment. Right now we're using an integrated modem Wi-Fi that was provided by Comcast. It's completely inadequate if we improve the service tier at the library. So two of the items we need to acquire are a separate modem, broadband modem, and a wireless router in order to support the increased service. Now, in discussions amongst the trustees, we've explored the option of a page such as you encounter when you log into the free Wi-Fi at Frontier or at Sunderland Elementary School, where you have to accept the terms for usage before you are allowed to use the service. And we think that would be a prudent thing to introduce before people are allowed to log onto the wireless system at the library. But passwords the password is either freely distributed, so any patron of the library can use it, in which case it's basically public information anyway. The other part of this is there are no proprietary systems that you can access, Sunderland proprietary systems you can access if you log on to the library's wireless system. So you may use that system to do some mischief somewhere else, but that could happen with a patron who's already in the library and logged on. So this would not materially affect their ability to do anything like that. And now that the library systems would be potentially compromised by someone sitting in the parking lot with an iPad or a smartphone that had access to the library system.
To create a question over.
The cost that you were quoted, was that quoted by Comcast?
Yes.
And that's the discounted municipal?
Yes.
And you may or may not know this, but are all municipalities quoted at the same rate by them? No matter what your size is?
I'm not sure about this based on the size, it's just the municipal discount.
So it's free and then the upgrade to 1600?
Yeah.
A download speed of 100. I think you have the upload and download. Yep.
Okay.
Should be download of 100.
So to go to 100, it's $130 more.
Yes.
Did you look at Verizon? I don't know if we have.
ESL?
No, not the ESL. The.
Fire. I don't think we have fire.
We don't have that. Yeah.
And they start putting it in. So. Down the road, the library, we do have the library connected to the MBI, right?
Yeah.
So that could be an option down the road. It's not going to solve a problem now, but we have all the municipal buildings are connected into that. So if it could be a viable option down the road. But
this cost can exponentially increase annually if you don't watch it. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Then you're dependent on it.
Mm-hmm. And are you just putting in one router, or are you, okay.
Just and that'll serve it. If needed, we would add like a repeater extenders in the building,
right.
But that's not.
Yep.
Will they pay to upgrade your hardware?
No.
Will they provide you with
upgrading? No, the hardware that ISPs provide is generally stuff that's close to end of service life. And yeah. it's We feel that if we're going to upgrade to a higher service tier, we should get a router with.
And they don't have the equipment to go with the higher service tier at all.
They usually do, and they charge you per month for renting.
Yeah. Yeah.
We don't want to build
it.
We
want to buy it and own it. And,
yep. Mm-hmm. And install it.
Okay. I think what maybe Tom was asking is like if you go to Panera, you have to log into Panera, and that way, when you log into Panera, mm-hmm. even though it's a free thing, you don't need a password. You at least accept their terms and conditions, and now they know your MAC address. So if there was something crazy going on, or you could prevent certain websites from being loaded on the library's service, so you can have some control over it.
Yeah, once we have the new equipment, we can add that splash screen.
Right,
so as soon
right,
as people connect,
right.
they have to accept.
Right.
That makes sense, and especially if there's ever an investigation,
mm-hmm.
they've got recourse there.
Yeah.
Note to self, next time we negotiate with Comcast, and we can add this into it.
Just finished.
Yeah.
10 more years.
They'll be in 10 years.
Well, exactly. I'm not holding my breath on that.
Room of that
stuff,
10 years.
I'll call.
Yeah.
So right now you guys are standalone. You don't come in with a town at all, right?
No, we have our own system.
What's that, Bruce?
Why can't you combine it with the town?
That's what I was going to ask Sherry because
by location,
on your same,
I believe that's why each building is separate.
It's treated like a physically separate.
Yeah.
Yep.
And there's an extra charge for that.
Well, and I'll just throw in two other words. It's Comcast.
I mean, put like a Nighthawk right here, which would cover that.
Well, you could. You could.
Extender on the, you know.
That's an option, actually. Like, yeah.
Or you can
sip
off of our Nighthawk.
Yeah.
When you call them up and you ask for a quote, you talk about the logistics of your building. Are you dealing with somebody that just deals with municipalities? Are you dealing with the person that I call from my house? I'm just wondering if you're specialized.
After many attempts, I finally found their municipal. They have a municipal. Yeah, person. Yeah, I can share that with
Sherry, anyone else who
wants to know. I found that person because no one else knew that there was a municipal discount.
Maybe worth me engaging in.
Bruce?
Like Amber says, town wide in the center of town. Could we set something up like that everybody uses the municipal area?
I don't
know what that is or what the cost is.
It'd cost money, you know,
it's
but technically
expensive.
You could. Well, yeah, because even if you blanket like this area, it's not going to be cheap, you know. It's something to look at.
The combined cost that we're doing, would it?
Well, I think it's good. It's a good question, because one of my concerns is that, and I'll use the, I'll reference copy machines. Well, we need a copy machine. They need a copy machine. Highway department needs, school needs three, Frontier needs seven. And we've never gotten around to, and we keep asking, but we sometimes said, well, wait a second, why don't we all go in together and lease our copy machines together? We'll probably get a better deal. But then we always have this, well, I need this, they're not overlapping. So what we end up doing is we have all these separate contracts, and one ofs usually you never get the best deal on one ofs. So I would maybe, because we have this office here, we have the library there, we have the highway to garage police department, maybe we should look at trying to negotiate in total with Comcast instead of just one at a time. Now, the library is a little different because they're their own separate board of trustees by law, so they are in themselves a unit, but they're still part of the town of Sunderland. They always have been, and they're a nice part of town also. But maybe Sherry, maybe we need to look at that.
Right. I'd be happy to, to go into something townwide as long as it's providing the level of service that our patrons need. And the fact
it sounds like you don't have very good service now.
Well, no. Right now.
So anything better than now is better.
Yeah, exactly. So, the thing is, this is an immediate need. So I'm very happy to have these discussions in the future. But the thing is, we really need to do this now.
And we also didn't lock into a contract with this, right?
No,
because we didn't take any equipment or anything. So six months from now, there's another solution. We'd be happy to change it up.
Good point.
I guess, and I would defer to Jerry, but it seems that the one difference is that although we have our staff uses the internet, obviously, we're really providing a public service, and it's really, if you think that the mission of the library, a big part of the mission is to provide research and information, that a lot of that information now is coming rather than versus the town hall, police, highway, where you're really, looking at supporting staff. So that, that's probably a different level of security and kind of a different mission.
Oops. Just as a note, I know it's a great service because when we travel, we always look for the library. Park in the parking lot. And what you got to do when you move on.
Oh, you know. That.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. It's free.
Every time we go in the budget cycle, it's the same thing. And you kind of like put the disclaimer out. It's like, we're all on the same team. We're just trying to do it as efficiently and as economically as possible. And I would say that we shouldn't, just because someone questions how money is spent, it doesn't mean they're against upgrading the services. Okay. They just want to look out for all of ours, because most of us, if not all of us, and people say people live in apartments aren't taxpayers, and I disagree, because part of their rent goes to paying taxes, but all of us in our town pay taxes, and we should try to provide the service, but try to do it at the best thing. And my only question, my only very concern is that if we wouldn't be able to upgrade Comcast until July 1st of 2017 anyways, so we have 6 months between now and then, we should explore those options now instead of waiting until that time. So I think you have time to explore those options between now and town meeting, because town meeting is 3 months away, and to look at what it would fully cost. We may not be able to do anything different. We may be able to do something different. But
have you ever
go ahead, Scott.
Have you ever had it mapped out to know if the neighbors are riding on your wireless? There are neighbors who live right near there.
Yeah, no, I'm sure they do, but I don't, just like walking around with my cell phone when it connects to it. I don't connect until I'm in the parking lot. Okay. Across the street,
I get the signal. Connected. Yeah.
Just want to ask the simple question.
I mean, parents during baseball games definitely hang onto it, but across the street doesn't seem to reach that far.
Okay.
going to have to put a user's fee on the ballpark.
You can put a limit on it, cap it out. Copy shops do it all the time.
Give them a break.
Sure.
Let's text the leaguers. I don't know. You said that.
That's okay.
When you're kind of speccing out what the speed that you wanted with the new router, once the level of service gets better, I assume more people will be trying to use it.
Mm-hmm.
Is that kind of, did you look at what other places with similar user numbers? Because I know Sunderland also has more library users per population than other towns, right?
Yeah.
So how does that work out? Is that built into the speech that you guys are looking at already?
We're going with the highest tier that they offer. And it's only, it's only recommended for 8 to 10 users. I mean, so even that is not what we would ideally want, but it's the best that Comcast is offering at this time.
So I didn't really
look at what other libraries have because that's what we have.
So Comcast basically doesn't even offer a level of service that we would want.
No.
Not at a municipal rate.
Yeah, right. You'd have to step up into commercial.
Higher throughput, but we would be paying a premium over the municipal rate. So
how big is the jump?
At least $100 a month.
Yeah.
It could double.
So this is a try it. See if it's, if it's not enough, we come back and we work on other stuff, but we need to do something.
Yeah. You can always change it. I assume we can change it. Catherine can address this. The investment in the router and the modem they have a fairly long service life. So that's not the issue here, but we could adjust the level of service at any time.
That's just a long-term?
Yeah.
It's not a long-term contract.
Okay, thanks. Next.
The next line is the library expense. We are not asking for any increase in that line. What we have this year helps us meet the municipal appropriation requirement and the material expenditure requirement. So we're leaving that the same for now, although we're going to talk about that.
I'm going to take over and talk about the salary, staff and director salary, so that Catherine doesn't have to talk about her own salary. But I think this is a good segue because we look at the budget pretty carefully. When we come in with what we ask for is not what we want. Of course, we want more than this, but this is what we've whittled it down to by the time we get here. And I think that some of the things we've discussed are sort of show the way that we approach the budget, where we can fund sort of one-time expenses out of donations or something. That's what we'll do. But we try to, limit what we ask the town for recurring expenses. And yes, we are budgeted to meet our materials expenditure requirement. Over a third of that money is coming from our annual fund. We embark on every year. I'm sure you all get letters. Really a personal expense. We all take the time to try to raise that money so that we are not asking the town to even fully support the books that we are buying.
Can I ask, are we meeting the required escalation in circulation materials for the state?
Yes.
Okay, great, thanks.
So in terms of salaries, we've done this is over my 20th year doing this, and I've seen it go many different ways, and so what we thought really was the smartest thing for us to do this year is to actually tell you guys what we want, because we get a little confused. Sometimes it seems like you want the COLA in there or you don't want the COLA in there. You want the COLA to come, from finance or from personnel. You kind of want to know what we're looking for in a merit and a equalization raise, and sometimes it seems to get lost. And honestly, I've several times gotten into town meeting not knowing what's really going to be in the budget. So we decided we're just going to tell you what we think makes sense, and we are happy to jump through any hoop we are supposed to jump through. We would love to meet with the personnel committee. We fully support, same scrutiny of wages throughout the town, but we feel it's our responsibility to support the library staff. So to start with the support staff, we have suggested that there would be a 2% COLA. I don't know where that's going to flush out with the town, but we are also looking at equalizing their hourly rate, and if you go to the comparison chart, you can see that we have been modest. In general, we are still going to be below the average for libraries in our region. We try to do a fairly comprehensive list. It's always hard to say what are the comparable libraries, because we are a small town, but we have a really excellent library that provides a lot of service with very low staffing. When you look at the hourly rate, wages, and, you know, library work is not a high-paying job, but we feel that our staff should be at least in the realm of the average. When you look at the hourly rate and you compare it, numbers that you hear for where the minimum wage is going, it's really not, as an employer, I think as employers, we feel it's our responsibility to really push for this. You know, that at least two of our support staff have been with us for 15 years or more. So even really, you know, the average doesn't really reflect the kind of work that we're getting at. People read our long-range plan and the surveys that were done. The quality of our staff is one of the things that people really appreciate about the library. And then with the director's salary, we also were assuming around 2% COLA, and we are looking at a merit increase, which would put her salary at, you know, in the realm of the average, slightly higher than the flat average of the hourly rate. We think that we are fantastically fortunate to have found Catherine. We would like to reward her for the work that she's doing and to make sure that she is adequately paid. And honestly, you know, when we kind of fall short, you know, you fall short 1 year and then you're further behind the next year and further behind and further behind, we really feel that we need to catch up with them and put our staff first.
Okay. One question. When I see merit, those, the term to me says that the there's criteria for merit to be raised, you know, to, so you have, you say merit, someone has met certain goals.
We do an annual review of our director.
What's that?
We do an annual review.
But, I would guess that somehow, somewhere there's expectations and there's actually published goals that we're aspiring to. Okay, I just never have seen them.
Yep. We have a job description and the evaluation form and a contract.
So when using the term merit, it'd be nice to, and then how do you set accomplishment of certain goals with a related percentage of merit? And again, those are just things I'm used to seeing when someone says merit. But you're kind of discussing a couple different points. You're discussing merit, but you're also doing wage comparisons. And so I guess are we specifically looking at merit, or are we looking at wage comparisons?
Well, I guess the reason that we call it merit for the library, I think, let's go back to support staff. First of all, I just want to say one thing that I feel very strongly about, which is that I think that we have a very legitimate discussion, can the town afford this? But I think, you know, do these employees, particularly the support staff, deserve this? I hope we can all agree that in a perfect world, this is what we would do. So for the support staff, wage equalization, I mean, we're looking at employees that are across the board below the average hourly wage. So we are just really trying to get them honestly to closer to the average and to something, you know, to a living wage. For the library director, we will fully admit that her salary right now, and we are talking about, you know, a couple thousand dollars. We are not talking about tons of money. That merit, that 4% increase is $1,800, almost $19. that her hourly wage right now is roughly, you know, is a little below the average, and now we're looking to get a little above the average. So, you know, we could call it equalization, but we do want to actually acknowledge that we are rewarding what we think is really an outstanding performance. And we do do a written staff evaluation every year.
Okay. David, Scott, questions?
A couple, if I could, while we're talking about salaries. Look at the, and thanks for printing out something that these tired eyes can read. If I look at the salaries and averages, et cetera, director's hourly salary is one value. Director's annual salary is a different value. The director's annual salary is greater than the list average, and yet the hourly salary is slightly below.
Because not all directors work the same number of hours.
Yeah, understood. I just want to make sure we're calculating it one way or the other.
Yes.
Right? Because you can easily go, well, this is an hourly rate. Jump that up.
I think the reason that we went to the hourly rate is that it's very hard to look at that annual salary because of the variation in the number of hours that people work.
And then lastly, all the way to the end, if I look at total salaries expenditure per capita, we're like just a whisker below the average. That's across your entire salary range. Far right, second page. Total salary expenditures per capita, 25.38. Average across the Commonwealth, 25.98.
To get to that point, if you look at circulation per capita.
I'm looking at per capita, right? Salary dollars per capita.
I'm turning it over to our economist.
Yeah. No, I'm just getting, if we're going to go to town meeting and have a discussion, we're going to have the discussion, at least a dry run here. It looks to me like it's not particularly out of whack if I aggregate the whole thing up.
Who is state average?
What's that?
The state average is 30.62. The list average, which is our local thing, is 25.98.
So 25.38, right? This is the information from the library under total salary expenditures per capita.
Right, right.
25.38.
And then 25.98 is just our local areas. And then
list average.
Across the state, the state average is 30.62.
I'm not comparing right. Wellesley.
Yeah.
Right? I mean, we can compare national average. We can compare Anchorage, Alaska. We can compare a lot of things. We choose a group, like choose a body. Right?
If we're to go out to hire people to be tomorrow, and to hire somebody, what could we do there?
But
that's a good point, Francis.
That turns into the question about turnover as well, Francis.
True. But again, my point is we have to keep. I mean, the way you saw that when we have to go out to get somebody new, we're not that far behind that we have.
Well, I agree. If I was looking at the salary and I was going to look at a posted salary, I would say Sunderland pays above the list average.
But all things considered,
I completely agree with the point. As someone who employs and is looking for qualified, wonderful help, I get it. I totally get it. But if I look at this information here, annual salary director 47, list average 42. Seems to me we would be attractive.
So
I know, and you know how much I love the library. I need to be the Libra right here.
Sorry, that 42 though is based on the average number of hours, which would be 32.24. So you have to look, really have
so
to.
So we had to rejigger the numbers. Okay.
Right. Yeah, I was gonna say that totally salary percentage. That's not adjusted for library hours too. That's why I was took me a while.
Do we pay hourly? Or do we pay salary?
Salary.
So you pay a fixed value of 47 and change over the course of the hours you work. So the hourly rate's not even germane to the discussion.
It is when you compare it to what other towns, what
I understand.
Are paying compared to what they
we put that to sort of normalize the salaries.
I totally get it.
I'm sure you understand.
I totally get it.
We really try to make her work as many hours as possible.
Don't do that.
I have to go to the hourly rate when you're talking about some people working 18 hours a week and some people working 32.
In some places pay overtime, some places don't. If it's salary exempt, salary non-exempt, there's a lot of ways around it. Again, I think it's important if we're going to bring that story forward that we have something that doesn't get poked as easily as, you know, this crusty old guy poking holes in it.
Sometimes you can make the argument that salaries appropriately raised for retention purposes.
Agreed.
Right.
And here. Actually goes back to this point.
Right. And then I think we did, was it 2 years ago? I'm trying to remember now. We did some adjustments to some of the library. I'd have to go back and look and see, because we're going to be...
Two budget cycles.
Yeah.
To the support staff, and correct. We're still behind.
I think the last time we brought that up to the minimum. I don't think it was to the average. Yeah. I think that's what it was.
You're right.
If I recall. Yeah. So that just gets to that. So just another thing we've got to make sure we're clear on. You know. Okay.
Anything else, Scotty?
No, that's all.
Finance Committee, Bruce?
The other thing I think we have to consider when we're considering salaries is the benefits that they get. Our health insurance benefits are probably much lower than every other town.
Yep.
And the positions that aren't benefited, which I believe is all of them except the library directors.
Head of youth services is my benefit.
Is benefited also?
On a part-time basis, yeah.
Okay, but I think that has to be taken into consideration.
Agreed.
And if we get people with not taking benefits, we should pay them more to compensate for the benefits. Because the benefit package is a big thing when you look at a total job prospect.
Right, the whole package.
Right, you have to do a total comparison.
Yes, yes.
And more numbers to run.
The turnover for the library director has been, what, about every 2 years you're turning over?
Not quite that, yes, it seems like that.
Yeah. But I mean, it's important that you have some stability there.
Well,
you know, I think the town can afford a few more bucks for the employees.
When you're talking about the benefits for the support staff, I mean, they're only working, none of them works even 20 hours a week.
Right, right, right.
Yeah.
You know, they're working minimal hours a week at minimal wage,
right.
And no benefits.
Yeah, so we had a staff member retire this year, and there was no way I could put forth to refill her position at 6 hours a week at, you know, about a little over $15 an hour. There's no way I'm going to find someone who's qualified to do the level of service that, you know, our patrons expect, our residents expect. So instead I combined it with another position, which is great, but then he's getting close to where he should really be receiving benefits, but, you know, he's not. And I, you know, I just want to pay him what he, you know, what his work deserves.
Right.
Questions more from Finance Committee?
I've got a couple.
Two.
What does the alarm system monitor?
It is security, so if anyone breaks into the building,
I'm headed there next.
Thank you.
It's also fire.
So it's when the library's closed?
Yeah, when the library's closed, it's called the alarm. Or anyone can come
to. Fire. Yeah. We put out fires all the
time. And that's basically like Detecto Guard, the alarm goes off. They have someone they call first, then they have someone else they call.
It's the monitoring,
then
yeah.
They have someone else they call.
Well, the alarm goes directly to the monitor, which is not necessarily someone sitting in Detecto Guard. It's whatever company they contact
to.
They immediately call the police. The police respond.
In the ideal world.
It should work out, but yeah.
You don't have any cameras set up on the outside entrances to monitor what's going on?
No, they gave us a proposal for that, but we couldn't justify the cost of that. There was that proposal and it is an option, but just I'd rather have a working fire suppression system than cameras outside.
Yes, there is sprinklers in the library.
Got all that stuff in there.
Yeah, the library.
Oh, that's right. We have the glide call goes in the overhead.
I do have issues with the alarm services because personally I think they're ineffective.
Mine works as a fire
department.
What's that?
I
said mine works as a fire
department. So it does work. I've been working, you know, like while they're doing repairs on the system, they've accidentally had a call go through, and the response times is actually very fast. So it does work, but it's just my problem with the current company that we have is that, you know, I get a phone call from the monitoring service, who I should have nothing to do with, saying that they haven't received a signal in over 2 months.
Right.
You know, and I had no notice of that. No one, you know, and so I call our company up, and he's just unconcerned. Oh, it's not a big deal. It's a big deal to me. So I'd rather go with a company, even if it costs $14 a month more, I'd rather go with a company that is actually going to provide us with the service that we're paying for.
Is that the same company that does this building?
I was just going to ask that question.
Yeah, we applied this year for loss control grants through Maya for the public safety building, town office building, and library, and we had wanted to do some upgrades to include cameras and stuff, but the grant was only partially funded, and that was for this building. So unfortunately, we weren't able to make the improvements that we had hoped to, so you'll probably see capital requests coming from public safety as well for improvements to their system. So.
And so we're not asking for a capital request to improve the system. The library is happy to cover that cost ourselves with, you know, out of gifts, but we would like the town to cover the monitoring fee.
That makes sense. Can you talk a little about the building expenses and where you guys are putting the Schedule Z savings from the PV system? It's about 28% of your electricity cost is being absorbed right now.
I haven't seen that yet.
I understand we haven't seen it, but yeah. Is there consideration of that in the proposal?
No, because that would be come out of
energy you're operating.
That would come out of that other month, the line item that's actually not
Is that
in building operations?
The electric.
So before I go too far, does everybody on the finance committee understand what Scott's asking about?
Whether this TV thing down
here? Okay,
yeah,
Scott.
More offsetting.
Correct.
Yeah, so the total size of the project, although smaller than originally intended, is greater than the. We schedule Z'd a portion of that to spread it across the town utilities. And the library was the second largest recipient, that being the school was primary, the library second. It's at the 28 or 32% of the total annual electrical cost is going to be picked up by that project. And I understand we haven't seen it yet, but the system is live. So it'd be interesting to know when we start seeing and how we respond to that.
Yeah, so I just had no knowledge of how we're exactly going to see that in anything. So if it's just a lower bill each month, then obviously that money would be going back to the town. If they're sending me a check or something, I don't know.
So now you'll see it on the electric bill?
Yeah.
So there's a reduction in the electric bill.
In the electric bill.
Yeah, so then that money's left, and that's usually money that just gets returned to the town, and then in the next budget cycle, we would probably
adjust accordingly.
Yeah, and so if it turns out, I just can't budget for that without actually seeing the numbers.
Okay.
Because, our electric bill is $1,400 a month right now. So I just don't
want
to run out of
money. Sure. No. And rightly so. The last thing you want is have be underappropriated going into September. But we also have a contract, and we know by percentage is going to the library.
Right.
And the treatment plant.
And it's guaranteed.
School, and it's guaranteed for a decade.
It's guaranteed money.
Okay.
So it's coming.
So we've got to figure out. I think collectively across our two tables have got to figure out, okay, well, what does that mean? How does that go?
Sure.
So again, you're effectively thinking about a quarter off of your electric bill. But so that was the goal, actually. We wish it was 100%. That was the original goal, but we do what we can.
How much
has anybody seen that?
What's that?
Yet? Has the school seen that?
It hasn't been on for a full budget, a full billing cycle yet. It only just came on the last couple of weeks. But we are heading into July. We should have the beginning of enough data to trend, and we should know collectively, Finance Committee, Board of Selectmen, what that means going for these energy lines.
Right.
In this budget cycle that we're discussing.
Great. Yeah. And those are those by contract are guaranteed savings also.
Guaranteed.
Huh? Yeah, those are guaranteed savings. So it's not a hypothetical saving. They're factual savings. So, okay. David, anything?
I'm just wondering if there's something we can do with the alarm system. You know,
find a good monitoring service.
Yeah, it seems like we've had some issues here in the same building too, and take advantage of the cost benefit.
So the company that we're switching to is the company that
will be going to detect
regard.
Guard.
You know, what's the history of libraries getting broken into and stuff?
Well, it's
town halls. Ours has been broken into.
Yeah, but the alarm didn't work, did it?
We didn't have an alarm at the time.
Oh, okay.
What's equally more sinister is there's a fire alarm associated with that in an unsprinkled building. So we want to, yeah, we absolutely want to have that so it goes
on. So that sprinkler system there too.
No, it does not.
And so the, I mean, the biggest concern in terms of security for us is people being locked in the building overnight. People will try to hide out in the restrooms and stuff. So you just don't, you don't know what, if they're just looking for a warm place or if they want to take the computers. I mean, it'd be very easy to do so if there was no motion sensors in there to detect someone staying overnight. Luckily, we haven't locked anyone in there, but if we were to do so, it would, they would be picked up immediately. There's no hiding from them.
Remind me to share the story about a cat in a furniture store sometime.
It's becoming an internet craze.
It took a long time, but they finally figured out there was a cat. And I was like, really? Anyway. Setting off the alarm at night, exactly.
Better worse than a rat. Then.
No, it's actually, well, it depends on where you're on the food chain. I suppose a cat's probably better. Capital, you have one piece that is HVAC, again, a replacement?
Yep, it's the same thing as last year. So we have not had to replace any this year. We're very thankful. We're hoping we don't have to replace any next year, but the truth of the matter is that they are aging and eventually they will start to break down. So we just would like some money set aside so that in that event we can replace some of
the pumps, right?
Yes.
Actually, the air handlers. The air handlers have subsequent compressors in them. The circulation pumps have been pretty reliable. Could I share that when our next Green Communities round is we're applying for these, we look for engineering services to look at that building again, especially on the air handlers?
Yeah, we are doing that right now.
Great.
Yeah, we've just finished up our energy audits for all of the town buildings and lighting we did last week, so we're just waiting for the reports.
Great. I say it because of vintage, not because of the core design.
Yeah.
You get to that kind of autumn years in the life cycle, you get a change in technology, and you know, you might make out.
I do think it's, I was going through it, the wireless, it says the, we frequently receive complaints from our patrons that our wireless internet is too slow. So it's free.
My house too.
It's free.
The injury has never stopped people from
and these days there's an expected minimum no matter where you go. I mean, you know, it's just part of modern life, you know. You gotta have a certain internet.
Pay for it.
I just have one question on it. Is there gonna be a process where we need to go to personnel and how are we gonna find out about that?
Yeah, you can come. We're actually trying to schedule a meeting for next week. But typically, you'll just send a request over to meet with us to go over it. So whenever you're ready, you can shoot us an email over. We can schedule our the next available meeting. So. Okay. We'll try to put you on the agenda for the first, the one, once we get this one scheduled. So.
Okay, anything else? That was short.
It was an easy one.
Do you have some questions for the library? Okay. Alex?
Also looking at cuts to our small libraries and networks, which reduces our rate to cover CWMR. So the $7,778 that we pay in CWMR fees was reduced by about $2,000 due to that grant. So if that goes down, that's going to go up probably by another $1,000 or so.
Okay.
Great.
Next week?
Who are we seeing next week?
Next week, maybe 300. I don't have confirmation yet. The 300th anniversary committee will be presenting a budget.
Do you want to bring somebody else in also?
If you remiss
I'm trying, but we're waiting. Fire department's waiting on bids for the FERCOG that opened on the 14th. Maybe police. I'll check with Eric.
Okay. All right. Thanks, library.
Thanks.
Thank you, Hollis. Beth, thank you. Kath, nice job, Kath.
Thanks.
Every year it gets easier. Just easier.
Have a good night.
Thanks, you too.
Do you want to look at this?
Okay.
I was going to try to put it in a little bit more logically. You just have to kind of match.
We have faster internet. Faster internet.
Yeah.
I've actually never tried
what to. What was certified? This is
one.
Well,
only time someone tried to use it in there.
Yeah, well, I understand.
Been turned back every year.
Okay.
We had.
But you know, it's interesting also. I mean,
yeah, we're going to talk.
Is it a public service?
Huh?
Is it a public service?
Well, and part of it is they might be
relying mostly on wireless stuff just for their own use.
Right.
That's the thing.
As opposed to hardwired network. I agree with that.
Yeah.
The place is wired.
Mm-hmm. Like physically, right?
Physically wired. Yeah.
Yeah. I would have expected
there's a solid network as part of the base design of the building.
Right. So like all your terminals that are set in there are all hardwired.
It's been extended a couple of times. Yeah. So it's been expanded upon a couple of times.
Yeah, because based on when we built that, hardwired was the way to go.
Still is in a lot of ways.
Yeah.
Great.
So right now it is hardwired.
Stations are wired, yep.
Yeah.
So what would be the advantage?
Offices are wired.
So why would you...
Why would you expand it?
Why would you go with wireless if everything is connected? What would be the reason
I'm
for
sure
that?
There's a patron's request around that.
Yeah.
It's sitting at a station that's busy all the time.
What's right? that?
You know, it's sitting at a station that may or may not be occupied all the time. But anyway, it's worth a tour. It's pretty well wired.
But if it's wired, I mean, that's...
Thanks.
I think what it is now is wired is one facet of the service delivery. You know, that you have to look at. And you there's a certain expectation now that you need to provide some
from
type
who?
Of wireless.
From who?
Well, them, Tom, them. This is the age of them.
I'm not, I understand where you're going.
Yeah. Well, I mean.
I get it.
You have to. I'm not saying, again, when I was traveling around, I knew where. I could stop.
You know, and, so right.
Well, I could stop and do my. I could write out if I was coming driving back from Burlington, Vermont. I could stop at certain locations, do my report, file my reports, and then go on
right.
to my next job. I understand that, but at the same time, if you're fully wired, which I thought we were,
at the library,
and again, yeah. we had the discussion here originally when about do we wire the whole build or go wireless? There was a concern about. Security state
yep.
in that why those thought and I think that we learned that with the protections that are afforded today that you could go wireless. We had the concern inside this building that we wouldn't be able to penetrate some of the walls because of the density
right,
of the
it's
walls.
Thick brick and
so we there was a thought that we would have to wire, but we ended up not having to.
You kind of end up doing a hybrid these days, you know, depending on every facility is different too, like you're saying about the walls and stuff. Yeah?
Right.
Every building's got its own challenges.
So is it important to be able to? Is it important and to whom to be sitting out in the parking lot on wireless internet?
Well, I'm thinking more about the people in the library and like who's using that. To me, that's more of a question. You know, like what's the service needs in the library? Because you can't really do much about people glomming on outside, you know. I mean, although technically
although if you're
you could,
hardwired, you wouldn't.
Well, or you could. One of the things I was going to suggest, though, too, is you could, somebody brought up, too, like a cafe. Mm-hmm. You can post every day. You could change the password and post a new one on a little sign right at the desk. So that eliminates, for the most part, people driving up, you know, glomming onto your wireless. But I think the real question is what's the actual service need for patrons for wireless in the library? That's really like what you gotta, you know, focus on. And what's it worth to us? You know what I mean? As part of
I would agree with that statement.
Like, what do we think it's worth to us as part of the service that we provide? You know? That's kinda how we have to look at it.
Right.
And then, you know, and then maybe we can get a better deal somehow, you know. I think it's definitely worth looking at.
Yeah, I agree with you, David. I think, you know, you have to ask, you know, how many people are sitting in the library with their laptops
Right. As opposed to at a terminal looking at something.
Except on the terminal. Okay. And again, if you have higher speed for, and again, absolutely the higher speed, I can understand higher speed, especially if you're, you know, for your patron using the equipment inside the building.
Right.
And then our buildings are so close together. It's like,
well,
see,
you
and
run
that's
a wire. I know. You can just run a line across almost, you know.
We've done, my company's done point to point in municipal settings where there's a campus environment, i.e. a town hall, a public safety complex, a fire station, yep. And they just do it with WAPs.
Yeah, right.
And it comes into one building, whoever wants to manage it, one building, one account, and then off it goes.
Yeah.
You think about this school street piece, we have effectively three. You've got the historical, the swamp field historical, you've got the town office building, you've also got the library. Right. Largest user likely would be the library. But that doesn't necessarily mean they have to house and manage. Doesn't mean we have to, but I think creatively we could look at it almost as what is a wireless district here? Maybe the neighbors wouldn't want to glam onto it. Maybe they'd be willing to pay for it as
they
opposed
might.
To...
There's actually a number of issues there. And the speed issue will affect the hardwired things.
Mm-hmm.
Because, like, you put aside wireless for a second. If they've got a lot more traffic on their hardware, on their network just in general. Like their speed will, that'll cause a bottleneck. And then you tack on the wireless. They're going to be even slower than a wired user. So I think there's probably a number of issues to look at there.
That's a nice part about budget hearings. It tends to draw out
Well, you ask more questions, and you look at things, kind of poke at them a little bit and say, hey.
I don't mean opportunity, just fiscally. I mean practice and, you know, it's like, huh, wow, we really didn't know that, or we did know that, and how about this idea? I think it's a great thing.
Right. Unfortunately, we only have one, well, the school's a little separate, but at least, you know, we've got at least two buildings next to each other. So.
Did we ever put... an empty slot over to the library from here.
Mm-hmm.
So we have a conduit, right?
Mm-hmm. Point to point. You run fiber optic if you wanted to.
See, that's what I was wondering, if we connect them to this.
See, I guess that's what I was trying to say earlier. Sometimes,
beef up their speed.
Sometimes we think too much in our little box.
I agree.
And we don't tie the boxes together.
Right.
Do you want to take a look at that?
Yeah.
Thank you, Scott. I just think sometimes we look too close. Sometimes we don't look inside the box. We don't. And again, it's a personal problem with me. And I guess I know I should get over it, but I am from New England. That's what Bob Kraft said
today.
But it's funny because, you know, and when you look at the copy machines, I mean, you think about how many different leases we as a town have and then you look at all the. If you got Conway, Deerfield, Sunderland, Whiteley, how many copy machines do you think there are between the schools and the highways and the police department? You would think we could get together and just go out for one contract and we'd probably get a pretty good deal.
Right.
Or even like PCs, you know? But it's like the devil is like the timing of it. So
That's what we say, but it shouldn't be. It shouldn't be. We should be able to move beyond that, but there's ways to get out of contracts. I think we just sometimes feel we have to maintain our own separate thing. Anyways, moving on. So you're looking at Mr.
Yep.
Thank you, Scott. Minutes from January 23rd.
Mr. Chair, if I could make one modification of the minutes under DLT project ranking, the first sentence, Mr. Bergeron to submit ranking to town administrator. I think we did do that.
Yep.
If we could eliminate that one sentence and simply read motion to submit DLT ranking to TA, Mr. Pierce second.
Mm-hmm.
Again, we did do it.
I submitted mine too.
Yeah. The sentence reads it, you know, to submit. I feel like it portrays that effort, me being representative of the board. So.
Yep.
So maybe just eliminate that sentence if I could ask for that modification.
Okay.
With that modification, make a motion to approve the minutes.
Second.
Motion made and seconded to adopt the meeting of January 23rd as amended. All in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
3-0. Okay, next up, Board of Selectmen updates.
We have a couple of meetings this, thankfully they're on Thursdays, it's going to be a busy day, but 7:30 with the police negotiations. We are in a healthy round of negotiations. There's a very collaborative approach, and that approach, I think, is manifesting itself in very productive discussions. That meeting this week is 7:30 down the station. And then Thursday night, the RDI is coming to town. RDI just sounds like, you know, we should break into song. RDI is coming to town. And I think rightly so, Lauren and Sherry have worked together to extend an invitation to conservation, CBA, etc., to be participating in the discussion. I mean, it's really as much introduction. It takes in no way anything away from their future impact or role, but it is a nice greeting, and we get to talk directly to the development team that hopefully the 120 North Main brings forward in our next meeting or two to recommend that we move forward with to this body.
So your meeting, 120 is meeting this Thursday?
Thursday, 6 p.m., yep.
What time?
6 p.m.
6?
Yep, and again, that's with the design team. And that's important. There's some questions that came out of the 120 working group.
Mm-hmm.
And again, I give Lauren and Sherry credit for extending that opportunity for affected boards and committees to go in and participate in the introduction.
Okay. Anything else?
Nope, that's all.
David?
No, we're trying to get a personnel committee meeting for next week, so it'll be COLA time and start looking at that stuff. So our annual formula, and then we're also looking at some other comparative studies and maybe thinking about maybe doing one of our own too. So that will be a topic of discussion.
So. Okay. The... South County EMS is, I think at our last meeting we talked about talking to the South Deerfield Fire District to extend our lease a short time longer in the building. That I look like we'll have a place that will be ready for us by the end of this fiscal year, so we'll have to go into next fiscal year in the same location, the same configuration that we're in now. South County Senior Center, I still think we're making a good headway over there. We had the year-end report. We have new members from Sunderland that are actively engaged at the Senior Center, and that's a good thing. And I'd just like to remind people that, you know, Scott said it earlier when he talked about the importance of the discussion about budgets. Sometimes we all kind of work independently of one another because no one has enough time to oversee everything 100% of the time. And some of the questions that come out, it's important, I think, to ask the questions and to get a better understanding of what's being accomplished or what's trying to be accomplished. And the views that they're coming from. So, and I think having those discussions out there is good. I think it's okay to ask tough questions because we should. I think our residents expect us to have answers when they look at us. And so it's okay to have. It's okay to make questions or question what's being asked or trying to find a better way to do something. Those are all. I think those are all good things. And sometimes it may seem uncomfortable, but it shouldn't be. It should be, it's, you know, we work in the public domain. There are no secrets, and that's a good thing. And so these questions and if we, these are the questions that people, these are people, questions that people on the street are asking, so they should be answered. So, anyways, Sherry, anything for town administrator updates?
Just the Green Communities grant. We're trying to finish up the first round designation grant. So that we can apply under the new competitive round that's due in March. And in order to apply for that, we have to finish up using all of the funds that remain from the first round. And so we would like permission to apply $18,814 for the wastewater treatment plant dissolved oxygen sensor project to that remaining grant amount, and then to allocate the remaining 10% towards the town's administrative costs, which are eligible under the designation grant. We're allowed up to 10% of the original designation grant amount towards administrative costs. That will clean up the funds from the first round and allow us to apply for the next round. We had Guardian Energy come in and do energy audits of all the town buildings and look at lighting retrofits last week. Mm-hmm. And they'll be issuing their reports probably mid-February. And I had a conversation with the consultant, Dan Friend, who said they've identified about 18 or 19 cost-saving projects for us to consider.
And it makes sense with that administrative stuff, because I don't have to tell you how much more work you have to do. It's great that you can get these things, but you've got to do a lot of work for it.
Yeah, that grant's
got a lot of...
So if I was to follow the money to its final resting spot, it would go to the departments or administration of those elements of that grant. So it will effectively show up next year in free cash.
Right.
Okay. We have to vote in order of land taking, a land swap.
You want to move on the closing out of the Green Communities, Mr. Chair?
All right. You want to explain it, Mr. Bergeron?
Oh, there's two steps. The town administrator is suggesting to close out the existing round of Green Communities grants. Again, one of them is to apply for and use some of the monies already spent on the control system at the wastewater treatment plant. And the second, of course, again, was we're allowed to take a percentage of the construction total project cost and apply it toward administration, not unlike CPA it's allowed. By doing those two things, it allows us to close out this year's grant round and allow us to apply for next year's. If we kept an open balance, we couldn't apply.
Yep.
Okay. Motion?
Move to close out as recommended by the town administrator.
Second.
Motion made and seconded. All in favor, please signify by saying aye.
Aye. Aye.
Okay, the caucus. David, you have the dates? March 6th, I believe.
I don't have any of the dates on them here.
I didn't see here.
I did see them downstairs.
Yeah, downstairs.
It's all downstairs, yeah.
Okay, the caucus is March 6th, 6 o'clock. It'd be here.
Here.
Mm-hmm. Do you want me to go grab a copy of the warrant so we can read it?
That's okay.
We can read it next time.
The caucus will be here, and I'm sure it's March 6th. So
yep. Got it.
We'll state the time. But
move to sign the warrant as submitted.
The caucus warrant?
Yep.
We have a motion made.
Second.
All those in favor of signing the Citizens Caucus, please signify by saying aye.
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 Okay.
And then move the order of taking for, I think it's Parcel C?
Parcel C, yeah.
Okay, and that's the continuation of the land down by the river for the boat walk and the river walk.
Correct.
So we have a motion made to vote the order of the land taking.
Second.
Which is a friendly land taking, by the way.
Yes.
Motion made and seconded. All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
3-0. Anything else?
March 6th is Monday, so that's good.
Yeah, I'm pretty sure it was Monday.
Yep.
Okay, without hearing any more business to be conducted at this meeting, this time I will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Motion.
Second.
The motion made, seconded. All those in favor of adjournment signify by saying aye.
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 That's a 3-0. We will see you next week. Same bat channel.
That's right. Same bat time.
Same bat channel. Thanks, FCAT.